Last week, we didn't get to this. This week, we are. And so this is like a condensed version of last week's with the blanks and everything. We're going to start with Mark chapter 11, verse 12. We're going to read it. Is that okay? I'm doing it anyhow, but I just thought I'd ask. In the words of Pastor Creflo Dollar, ready, read. And on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. Speaking of Jesus and his disciples, Jesus was hungry. Next verse. I'm just going to read through here. And seeing a fig tree afar off, having leaves, he came, if haply he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. Next verse. And Jesus answered and said unto it, no man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it. Next verse. And they come to Jerusalem, and Jesus went into the temple and began to cast out them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. Next verse. And would not suffer or allow that any man should carry any vessel through the temple. Next verse. And he taught, saying unto them, is it not written, my house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. Next verse. And the scribes and the chief priests heard of it and sought how they might destroy him, for they feared him, because all the people were astonished at his doctrine or his teaching. Next verse. And when evening was come, he went out of the city. And in the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, saith unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursed is withered away. And Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. And for verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Next verse. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. Next verse. And when you stand praying, forgive if you have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses or sins. Next verse. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive your trespasses. Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for this revelation that we're getting ready to receive, and that we will understand these verses and how they apply to our life today. Go back to verse 12, please. In verses 12 through 14, and I want you, if you have your outline, verses 12 through 14. And on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. Next two verses. And seeing a fig tree afar off, he came if he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. And of course, the next verse, he curses the fruitless fig tree. Here's what the first thing I want you to see. Number one on your outline. Fruit is important to God. Fruit is important to God. Would you agree? Fruit is important. People don't see, there's a lot of people in the quote grace movement, I don't even like to use that, that don't realize how important fruit is. But fruit's not something you produce in your own strength. In fact, I believe that one of the ways we actually make the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5, 22 and 23, nine attributes of the fruit of the Spirit, we actually make it a work of the flesh when we try to do it in our own strength. For example, how many times have you heard, well, you need to do this, for you need to love your wife. Is that true? If you're married and you have a wife, you need to love her, right? As Christ loved the church. Wives, you need to reverence your husband. There's many examples we could use. But when I try to do that in my own strength without keeping my faith in him, I can actually make what's a fruit of the Spirit into a work of the flesh or my own strength. Right. See, the key to this walk is learning to abide in Jesus. John chapter 15, watch this. John 15, verse 4. Look at this. This is Jesus speaking, and it says, abide in me. That word abide means to reside, to stay put, to dwell, to settle, to make your abode in. Abide in me. Now, why would he say abide in me if it's automatic? You know it's a fight to keep your faith in Jesus. You know everything in this world will challenge you to get your faith in something other than you than him. I'm talking about as believers. So many people think that God loves them based on their obedience instead of his. I said that earlier. We bring every thought captive, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, to Christ's obedience, not Chris's obedience. Well, that rocked my world when I first saw that. You mean it's his obedience? Listen, my obedience fails. So does yours. See, so to abide in him means I keep my faith constantly in what he did. And that's a fight. That's a fight. That's why we need the anointing. The anointing, according to 1 John 2:27, teaches me to abide in him. Teaches me how to keep my faith in him. Amen. Boy, you can't hear that enough. Because I guarantee, and this is why we need our feet washed. Remember when we did that message? Let me show you something else that I didn't show you. Foot washing in John 13, it's not about the physical act of washing your feet. It's about having the word wash the part of you that touches this world. What part of you touches this world? Your feet. Because you're walking through this world. How many know your soul, your mind, your will, and your emotions are constantly in touch with this world? They're in touch with this world. So you need your feet washed. You need your soul washed. You need that washed by the washing of water of God's word constantly, because it constantly gets contaminated by this world. And Jesus said, if you don't have the part of you, your feet or your soul or whatever touches this world, washed consistently with the water of God's word, you won't partake of what Jesus has. That's what he said. Jesus told Peter, if you do not have your feet washed, you will not take part in me. You're born again, going to heaven, but you won't take part.
Come on.
My word, that's good.
Yeah.
See, the part of you that touches this world in with foot washing is talking about the symbolism in it, is that what touches your feet because you're walking through this world. But I guarantee you, how many this week have had something come at, we talked about fear. What is that? That's his soul touching this world. You know the language of this world? Fear. Fear.
That's right.
Everywhere you go, fear. You got to get this. Oh, you're this age. You got to get this. You got to do this. I think I shared it last week. I drove by I think it was CVS or whatever the other one is, Walgreens, and I saw on their LED sign, shingles shot. I always thought that was something you put on a house. But now they tell me it's something else. How many know fear tries to get on you? I'm not having it. I don't have to have it. You know what I'm sitting there thinking? This is what my wife and I were talking about. Listen, it's one thing that things come at us and there's no condemnation. But my word, if I'm going to go down, I'm going down swinging. I'm going down saying, by his stripes, I'm healed. I don't know. And I'm not going to blame God. I think that pleases God. I think faith pleases God. That sounds like scripture. Amen? So fruit is important. Jesus said, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine. No more can you except you abide in me. You cannot bear fruit unless you abide in me. People say, oh, I'm doing that. Are you? I was thinking today, I'm getting ready to do a post on this. You know how people serve money and don't even know it. If you don't have enough money, you think, well, God, I can't do what you've called me to do because I don't have enough of money. Or if I have a lot of money, I'll do what I want because I have the money. What's God saying? The Bible says I'm not my own. I'm bought with a price. Who's in charge here? My financial status or the leading of the Holy Ghost?
Hello.
Somebody hear that. That's what it means to abide in Jesus. I'm not my own. I don't belong to me. It's not up to me to do what I want. He'll put his desires in my heart. Then I'll do what I want. Can anybody hear that? Amen. Next verse. I am the vine. You are the branches. He that abides in me. You know, let's keep that straight. I am the vine. You are the branches. Watch this. He that abides in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. How many want to bring forth much fruit? What is this fruit? Well, we'll find out. For without me, you can do nothing. Aren't you glad you're not without him? Next verse. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. And men gather them, not God. Not God. Not God. Men gather them and cast them into the fire of their judgment, and they are burned. Next verse. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, look at this. You shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Boy, if you abide in me and my words, revealed word, rhema, abide in you, you'll ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Look at the next verse. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples. And I've told you before, the much fruit he's talking about is answered prayer fruit. God wants your prayers answered. But it's all contingent upon me abiding in him. So what is fruit? God wants, is fruit important? Yes. But look how good the fruit's abiding in him. Yes, I know the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering. That's the disposition. That's the fruit of the Spirit. But God wants much fruit, answered prayer fruit, to abide, to manifest in your life so he is glorified.
Yes.
We got one yes. That's awesome. Somebody say amen. God, it doesn't honor God when we don't see manifestations. It honors God when we do. God wants to show off through us. God wants to show an unbelieving world that he's real, not just religion. Hallelujah. So fruit is important to God. In other words, let me just give you second from the Amplified. 2 Corinthians 13:5. Amplified, please. Amplified. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. Examine and test and evaluate your own selves to see whether you are holding to your faith and showing the proper fruits of it. Test and prove yourselves, not Christ. Do you not yourselves realize and know thoroughly by an ever-increasing experience, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless you are counterfeits, disapproved on trial, and rejected? Titus 1, verse 16 from the King James. Paul's talking about the Cretans. And he says, they profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient and unto every good work reprobate. How many people have you ran into? Yeah, I'm a Christian. Listen, if you're a Christian, there's going to be some fruit. It's not talking about perfection.
That's right.
Amen. If you're under grace, there's going to be some grace fruit. Hallelujah. That went over big. All right. Now, back to Mark chapter 11. Mark chapter 11, verse 13. Watch this. Jesus was hungry. See the fig tree afar off. He came to it, if haply he might find fruit there. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. I'm going to cover the time of figs not being yet, but go to the next verse. And Jesus answered and said unto it, no man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it. Now there's a couple things. Go to number 2. Number 2 says, and go to Numbers 13, 25. Fruitless fig trees speak. Do you know circumstances speak to you? Amen? Do you know when you heard that report, you know, not only did he hear the report with his audibly with his ears, how many know it started speaking to him after that? How many know if you look at your bank account and there's not enough in it, it talks to you? How many know that situations talk to you? You feel this pain. I started running again on a regular basis with these guys, and all of a sudden I got pain here and then here. And it's like, I'm thinking, what is up with this? This ain't right. And you know, there's all these thoughts were coming at me. No one was saying it. Hip surgery. Yeah, that you're going to have. Guess what? I'm doing good.
Amen.
Next Olympics, I'll be watching on television. You thought I was going to say I'd be in it, right? No, but seriously, all these thoughts started coming on. I was going down, I was limping, and you know, people even commented. I thought, what is going on? Well, I just need to stretch a little more. But see, all these thoughts of, you know, the worst case scenario. And when you go to some of these places, they always got to give you the worst case scenario, right? What about the best case scenario? What about by his stripes we are healed? We believe that. I believe that. And I started thinking, no, I'm not taking this. I believe that by his stripes I'm healed. I mixed corresponding action with it, and I started doing something. It's fine. It's been fine. And I believe that's God's will. But there's all these things that come at you are invitations for you to take it.
Yeah.
That's right. How many know we're at a fight? It's called the good fight of faith.
Good fight.
You know what that means? It's a fight. It doesn't automatically just drop on you. Well, pray. See, we think God's up there. Well, I tell you, I really like you, Emerson, so here you go. You're blessed. But it's a fight. God's made salvation available to everyone. We'll see that here in a bit. But you got to partake of it.
Amen.
Amen. All right. So fruitless fig trees speak. Numbers 13, verses 25 through 33. Watch this. Numbers chapter 13. This is that Moses sent 12 spies into the promised land. The promised land is not talking about heaven. How do I know? You're not casting anybody out of heaven. So get that out of your mind. I know some of you are thinking, if so-and-so's there, I'm kicking them out. Not going to happen. So get over it. All right. But the promised land speaks of the abundant life that God's made available to us in Christ. That's the promised land. Now watch Numbers 13, 25 through 33. And there's, how many know, 12 spies were sent out. 10 of them came back with what the Bible calls an evil report. And the evil report wasn't a lie. They were acknowledging everything they saw. But it was evil because it denied that God could do this. Amen? That's what it denied. That's why it was evil. God calls that evil. Amen? But two spies, Joshua and Caleb, came back with the report of the Lord. Now watch this. And they returned from searching of the land after 40 days. Next verse. And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel and unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. Next verse. In other words, this is what's here, man. This is what's available to you. You know, some people think, well, this is available. Blessings available. Healing's available. Good relationships are available. All these things are available. This is the fruit of the land. But we can't do it. Because we're just sinners. There's no hope. We can't do it. But it's available. But you can't have it. That's not good. And they told him and said, we came unto the land whither thou sentest us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. It's a good land. Next verse. Nevertheless, the people be strong and dwell in the land. The cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. Next verse, the giants. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south. This is a side note. Can I tell you something? I don't usually do this, but I'll do it here because you guys are so awesome. But I remember studying, I studied what's called gematria. When you start getting into the depth of Scripture, you know it can't be man. You know it can't be man. Gematria, every Hebrew letter has a numerical value to it, a number, okay? And when I remember studying the Amalekites and Amalek. You know what the numerical value for Amalek or the Amalekites is? You know what it is? The exact same numerical value of doubt. Isn't that something? So what's that say to us? Doubters are in the land. Amen? But they were the enemies of the children of Israel. All right. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan. Next verse. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and say, this isn't true. He didn't say that, did he? See, faith is not denying the reality of a circumstance. You don't come and say, I'm not sick. I'm not sick. That's not what faith is. Faith does not call things that are as though they're not. It calls things that are not as though they are. Big difference. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. This is the victory that overcomes the world. 1 John 5:4. Even our faith in him doesn't mean, see, in order to have a testimony, you usually have a test. But we overcome. We overcome. I was talking to some people recently. I talked to Emerson. We were different people. And I said, you know, the key to success, just keep showing up. Don't quit. You can't lose. You know, when you're, you can't lose, right? Hold on here. I don't know what this is. Stay there. If you don't quit, you can't lose. You know, and it's easy to say don't quit, but it's, you know, you can still go through the motions and have quit in your heart. Do you know that? You can still be going through the motions. That's why I love the Holy Ghost. He keeps your hopes up. Now the God of hope, confident expectation of good, fills my heart with all joy and peace in believing that I abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. I don't understand it, but God gives me hope. And it keeps getting stronger and stronger and stronger. Oh no, and all the things come at you. You can't do this. You can't be what God's called you to be. You can't walk in what he's called you to walk in. And God says, we're well able to overcome because my faith is in him. It's Christ in Chris, the hope of glory, not Chris. And you too. That's how God wants us to think. And Caleb stilled the people. You know, some people you got to tell to zip it. Before Moses and said, let us go up at once. I love this attitude. And possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. Somebody say, well able.
Well able.
Next verse. But the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go up against the people, for they're stronger than we are. This situation's too big for us. Don't we feel that way at times? See, if you can handle what God's called you to do in your own strength, it's probably not God.
That's right.
Because God always calls us to something that's bigger than us.
Yeah.
I love it. One time my friend Cecil said something so good. He says, when God calls him to go somewhere on a mission trip, he goes, a lot of times I don't have the money, but I know God's called me, so I just go ahead and start planning it, and God provides. I thought, that's faith. But then, we can't. They're stronger than us. Next verse. And they brought up an evil report of the land. Everything they said was true physically, but God said it's an evil report. They brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eats up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. Next verse. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were, when we saw them, notice it's where we're looking. When we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And because we were grasshoppers in our own sight, so were we in theirs. You know, the Bible says the devil goes about as a roaring lion. He's not a roaring lion. He goes about to intimidate. And that's what things come at us for, is to intimidate. Praise God. So fruitless fig trees, back to your outline, they speak. We need to talk back. Isaiah 54:17. This is where I think a lot of people miss it. They think back, but they don't talk back. What do you mean by that? We think the promise, but we don't voice activate the promise. We don't speak the promise. We don't declare the promise. Watch this. No weapon that is formed against us shall prosper. Notice what it doesn't say. It doesn't say no weapon will be formed against us. Can anybody see that? It doesn't say no weapon's going to be formed against you. One more time. It doesn't say that there's not going to be weapons formed against you. It says they won't prosper. Watch this. And every tongue, somebody say every tongue, that shall rise up against thee in judgment, you shall condemn. When people begin speaking death over you, you can be nice, but you can be firm.
Amen. That's right.
That doesn't apply to me.
Thank you, Lord.
I just get a kick out of some things, and I'm going to try to be vague here. So say, they said, man, I'm really starting to feel strong doing this. I'm starting to feel like I'm getting in shape. It's like, age will take care of that. This is how people talk. This is normal talk, guys. It's not normal talk to me. I'm not denying you don't get older, but I don't believe we have to be decrepit. I believe we can be strong. Caleb was 85 and said, give me that mountain. I'm as strong as when I was 40. And he's under the old covenant. We got a better covenant than he does. Amen. What, three amens? You know what you're saying when you say amen? Four. That means so be it unto me. So when you say amen, say so be it unto me. All right. So every tongue that shall rise up against thee in judgment, you have to condemn it. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. This is your inheritance. And your righteousness is of him, saith the Lord. That's your inheritance, to be able to condemn the tongues that rise up against you in judgment. What does that mean? When they rise up and say things over you that Jesus has already been judged for, like sickness. It's flu season. Listen, there's no season that the Word of God doesn't work.
Amen.
None.
Amen.
Rise up against it. Listen, I go by signs and I see it. Get your shot this, get your shot that. And I say, in Jesus' name, not me. That's foolishness. Don't wake me up because I'm going with it. Hallelujah. We need to talk back.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That's what goes in that line. Number four, fruitless fig trees, back to Mark 11. They often look good. Fruitless fig trees from a distance look good. Amen? They can look good. You know, the Pharisees look good. You know, Jesus talked in Matthew 13 about a parable of the tares and the wheat. And you couldn't even tell the weeds, tares. You couldn't even tell the wheat and the tares apart. Amen? It can look good from a distance. In fact, let's look at this. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13. Watch this. 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming or masquerading themselves into the apostles of Christ. Next verse. And no marvel, for Satan himself masquerades, feigns himself as an angel of light. In other words, the devil doesn't have a red suit, a pointy tail, horns, and a pitchfork. He comes looking good.
Hello.
He comes looking good. Smooth talker.
What a Bible.
Amen. Amen. Smooth talker. Next verse. Therefore, it is no great things if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. In other words, back to your outline, fruitless fig trees often look good. Now, here's one I want to cover, because this came to me. This is really good. And back to verse 14, I think, of Mark 11, maybe 13, we'll see. Mark chapter 11. Back up one more. There we go. At the end of there it says, but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. The time of figs was not yet. Now what is this talking about? Doesn't it seem unfair to this fig tree that the time of figs was not yet and Jesus cursed it? But basically the fig tree looked good. What is this saying? Now, if you read on, which we did earlier, Jesus goes into the temple, right? And instead of people being able to go into the temple, the old covenant system, and being able to get a touch from God, they went in there and found a den of thieves. And Jesus, even though the time of figs was not yet, the new birth was not yet made available, people should have been able to go into the old covenant system and get a touch from God. But instead, they had made it a den of thieves. That's what he's talking about. You know the old covenant had glory? It's in your outline there, 2 Corinthians 3, verses 7 through 13. It talks about the glory of the old covenant, which glory fades in comparison to the new. So people, even though the time of figs was not yet, even though the new birth was not yet made available, people should have been able to go into the temple and get a touch from God. And what about figs? What does figs speak of? Let's go back to Genesis chapter 2. I want to show you this. Genesis chapter 2, verse, I think, 25. We'll see. This is Adam and Eve. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. Now, I've heard people say this. This is before the fall, that Adam and Eve were clothed with the Shekinah glory of God. No, they weren't. They were naked. That's what it says. It doesn't say they were clothed with glory. Well, why didn't... Look at this. They were not ashamed. They didn't even know. Now, go to after the fall, go to Genesis chapter 3. Go to about verse 7, I think. I could be wrong, but we'll adjust if we are. Genesis 3, this is after the fall. Back one more, 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good, this is being tempted by the devil, for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband who was with her, Adam. And he did eat. Next verse. Look at this. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Now what does fig leaves speak of? Fig leaves are man's attempts at self-righteousness and to cover his nakedness with his own strength, in his own strength. And you know, fig leaves represent our self-righteousness. You know, if I fear any sin in my life, it's the sin of self-righteousness. Because that's the one that'll stop the power of God in your life every time. When you start thinking it's about your goodness instead of his goodness, when you try to cover your nakedness with fig leaves or your own effort, amen. You know, this is another thing that I find fascinating. They were naked and they did not know it. You know why? Because they were so focused on the Lord that they didn't even recognize it. You know, man's religion is constantly making it about you not sinning or you not doing this or, you know, rather than being focused on Jesus. Do you know the Bible says, look at it, Hebrews 10, watch this. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. Hebrews 10 and verse 1. Watch this. For the law, having a shadow of the good things to come and not the very image of the things, can never, with those sacrifices, animal sacrifices, which they offered year by year, continually or habitually make the comers thereunto perfect or complete. Next verse. For then would they not cease to have been offered, because the worshipers once purged would have no more conscience of sins. God wants us to be so Jesus-focused that we're not sin-conscious. See, that's the key. Repentance is not turning from sin. It's turning to Him. And when you turn from Him to Him, you automatically turn from sin. Amen. See, we've got it backwards. People are trying to shovel the dark out of the room or patch the holes in the boat. You don't shovel the dark out. You turn the light on. The light's greater than the darkness. You get sun-focused, and then you're not sin-focused. I got heat on this one. I did a Facebook post about. I go, it's one thing to not sin because you're not supposed to, which is fine to some degree. Obviously, it's better than the alternative. But it's another thing when you don't because you don't want to. And this guy was telling me, he's running. He said, "You telling me," guy talk now, girls hang on. "You telling me," we're all believers, "you're telling me that if there's some good looking girl there and she's all whatever, that you're not going to be tempted?" Listen, I'm a guy. I'm wired just like every other guy. But you know, I love him more. And there's a power and there's a strength to turn away. My word, I drive a Rolls Royce. Why do I want to steal a rusted out Volkswagen off the street?
Come on. All right.
I'm referring to my wife, for those of you that don't know. But see, this is the point. You know, and when you're trying to fix yourself, when you're focused on yourself, it's an endless thing. You can't do it. You can't live this life. You have to abide in Him. You need to be sun conscious, and you won't be sin conscious. Now listen, I'm not saying I got everything figured out, but I'm growing and I'm a lot further along than I used to be. Hallelujah. This is the problem. Guys, let me just talk about pornography for a minute. That's Joseph Prince's way of saying pornography. Let me talk about pornography. Are we blushing? Anybody? Anybody nervous yet? You know, this is the hidden sin of the church. And it, I mean, it's out of control, guys. It's a drug, and it's everywhere. And I mean, I was sat in a pastor's thing, and they got this thing about, you know, there's all these courses of men to defeat pornography. And come. Listen, it's like heroin. You need to know that. It's addictive. It's wrong. It's bad. It'll destroy you eventually. Okay? I mean, there's all these things about how, and you know, I've watched them. I think, you know, I want to bring something to the body to help the body. But if it's all about focusing on how, man, I'm a man and this is the way I am and, you know, I'm always going to have this and it's never going to change. Once an alcoholic, always an alcoholic. You're never going to change. That doesn't change you. That changed you. Change you to the sin. You got to see who you are in Christ. You got to begin to identify with who He is. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and there's the grace of God in me, and it's bigger than this, and the desire to love Jesus is stronger than the desire for that. That's what'll change you. It's one thing to not do something because you're not supposed to. It's another thing to do something or not do something wrong because you don't want to. God's changed your heart. And see, this is why Satan hates the new covenant. So, you know, then we spend all of our life, instead of reaching a hurt and dying and lost and suffering world, we're just trying to hang on and fix ourselves. Most of the church lives there. I'm just fixing myself. I got to get my act together. I always tell people, get your act together, it's still an act. Amen. Think about that. That'll hit some of you later. All right. Oh, that's funny. All right, moving right along. All right. For them, when they... See, we have no more conscience of sin. Go back to Mark 11. There's stuff in your outline you can look at. And I want you to jump down to verse 20. 20 of Mark 11. And in the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up by the roots. You know, some of these things, you know, things have to dry up by the roots. Let me just say this to you. The Bible says in Mark chapter 16, we'll lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Now, it's great if there's an instant manifestation, but you know, how many of you go to the doctor and they give you a pill of antibiotic or whatever for something and you take it? Oh, didn't work. It didn't work. How do you know? You just took it. It didn't work. I just took it. It's not working. How many know it takes a little bit to get through your system? Amen. Some things take a bit. They have to dry up from the roots. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You read Matthew's account and immediately... There was something that took place immediately, but the ultimate drying up was from the roots. And that's how things, when you curse something, it dies. Thank you. Amen. And I told you before, how did Jesus curse the fruitless fig tree? He said, no man eat fruit of you from hereafter, from here on out. Don't no one to eat fruit of you. And we curse, the Bible says in James chapter 3, we bless God and curse people when we're constantly telling them, you'll never change. This is always this is the way your dad was, your mom. This is in your family. You can't ever. We're cursing people when we say that. Amen. Moving right along. All right. Growth takes time, dried up from the roots. New covenant is a shock to the religious mindset. That's true. I'm not going to elaborate for the sake of time. Number eight. Is your house, this is so good, a house of prayer? Or is it a den of thieves? Oh, glory. Is your house a house of prayer? Or is it a den of thieves? Let's look at this. John chapter 10, verse 10. John chapter 10 and verse 10. Look at this. Most of you know this verse. The thief cometh not before to steal and to kill and to destroy. Jesus said, I am come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. That's the devil, right? Some of you are afraid to answer, I can tell. It is the devil, but let me show you how the devil works. It's not just the devil. He has some accomplices. Back up to verse 1. Look at this. Look at John 10:1. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold. Who's the door? Jesus. Look at this. But climbs up some other way. The same as a thief and a robber. You know, anytime we try to approach God outside of Jesus, we end up losing or allowing to be stole what we rightfully have in Him. The thief here is anybody that climbs up some other way outside of the door, and the door is Jesus. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Open the door to the fruitless fig tree mountain is what I got written down here. Let me talk about this for a minute. John, I'm going to try to do this quick. Hang on. 2 Chronicles chapter 28. Look at this. 2 Chronicles 28. This is a wicked king. Verses 22 through 24. 2 Chronicles 28. 2 Chronicles chapter 28. Look at this. Verses 23 through 24. This is wicked King Ahaz. In the time of his distress did he trespass or sin yet against the Lord. Against the Lord. This is that King Ahaz. Next verse. Notice this guy is getting worse and worse. Verse 23. And he sacrificed unto the gods of Damascus, which smote him. And he said, because the gods of the kings of Syria helped them, therefore will I sacrifice to them that they may help me. But they were the ruin of him and of all Israel. Next verse. Look at this. And Ahaz gathered together the vessels. This is a wicked king, guys. He gathered the vessels of the house of God and cut in pieces the vessels of the house of God and shut up the doors of the house of God, and he made his altars in every corner of Jerusalem. So what did King Ahaz do? He did many things, but one thing he did was he shut the doors to the house of the Lord. Now jump over to 29 verses 1 through 3. Here's a righteous king named Hezekiah. Watch this. Watch this, watch this, watch this. Verses 1, 2 Chronicles 29, 1 through 3. First thing Hezekiah did in 2 Chronicles 29, Hezekiah began to reign when he was 25 years old, and he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Abijah, the daughter of Zechariah. Next verse. And he did that which was right. Somebody say good. In the sight of the Lord, according to all that David his father had done. Next verse. Watch what he did. In the first year of his reign, in the first month, he opened the doors of the house of the Lord and repaired them. Interesting. How important is the house of the Lord? If the doors aren't open, guess what could not have happened? Look at verse 22. Watch this. 22 through 24. We're getting somewhere. Hang with me. Look at verse 22. Ahaz shuts the doors of the temple. Hezekiah opens them. So they killed bullocks. And the priests received the blood and sprinkled on the altar. Likewise, when they had killed the rams, they sprinkled the blood upon the altar. They killed also the lambs, and they sprinkled the blood upon the altar. This is all good. Seriously. Next verse. Keep going. Next two verses. And they brought forth the he-goats for the sin offering before the king and the congregation, and they laid their hands upon them. Next verse. And the priests killed them, and they made reconciliation with the blood upon the altar to make atonement for all Israel. For the king commanded that the burnt offering and the sin offering should be made. I don't think I'm in the right place. I'm sorry. 14 through 16. If you were led of the Spirit, you would have known that. 14 through 16. I'm sorry. And the sons of Heman, Jehiel and Shimei, and all the sons of Jeduthun, Shimei and Uzziel. Next verse. Yeah, we're here now. And they gathered their brethren and sanctified themselves and came according to the commandment of the king by the words of the Lord to cleanse the house of the Lord. Next verse. Yes, this is where we're at. And the priests went into the inner part of the house of the Lord to clean it. How many know they couldn't clean it if the doors weren't open? Okay, now watch this. They brought all the uncleanness that they found in the temple of the Lord, in the court of the house of the Lord, and the Levites took it to carry it out abroad into the brook Kidron, which is where they destroyed it. Now watch this. In order for them to clean the inner part of the temple, the doors had to be open. How many of you know that in the New Testament, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19, I believe it says, you're the temple of the Holy Ghost, right? Amen. Psalm 141, verse 3. Hang with me. This is how important it is to open your mouth. Psalm 141, verse 3. Look at this. Set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth. Keep the door of my lips. How many of you know if you don't open your mouth, things can't get out? You know it's a fact that women live longer than men? You know why? They talk more. And serious, I know we laugh at that, but it's true. You got to let things out. This is why he went for your tongue on the day of Pentecost. The Bible says, he that speaks in an unknown tongue, he edifies himself. He doesn't edify his spirit. His spirit's already edified. He edifies himself. He opens the door. He allows the Holy Spirit to clean him out from the inside out. Amen. Open the door of your temple. So many people. Open it up. Let God, let it out. Somebody cut you off in traffic. Let it out. I'm serious. You're the temple. These things aren't in the Bible for just because, well, I need something to make up here. They are historical facts, but I'm telling you, they're there. All of it's revelation for us. I'm not joking when I say women live longer than men. And it's because they talk through their stuff. God wants us to talk through our stuff, not in a fleshly, carnal way, but by the power of the Holy Ghost. Open the door of your temple. Allow the Holy Spirit to build you up on your most holy faith. Man, that's good. That's so good. My word. Hold on, Christian. How much are we got? Fourth down. All right. All right, go back to Mark 11, 22. We'll start with 22. I want to show you this. This is what the prophecy Misty brought forth earlier. We're getting to it. And Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. Many people say have the faith of God. That's all fine. I believe he gives us his faith. Next verse. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say, somebody say, there it is again, say. Okay. Think that has to do with your mouth? Yeah. Notice it doesn't say, for whosoever shall think. Not going to think of that. That's what we do. Say it. Say it. Talk back. For it shall say unto this mountain, whatever problem you're dealing with, what do you say? Be thou removed. Be cast into the sea. And shall not doubt, there's doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass. There, say again. He shall have whatsoever he saith. But here's what I want you to see. Shall not doubt. I love this. I love it. You know the Greek verb? I used to think it was, well, doubt comes and you can't help it. The Greek verb is in the passive voice. What does passive voice mean? It comes, but you just say no to it. It's not active. It's not something that overpowers you. It's something where I can say no to doubt that comes at me. He said, here's what it should say. And shall not receive doubt in his heart. Oh, my word. That don't light your fire? Your wood's wet. Amen. You don't have to take it. All right, you want a rock song? Where's my hair? We're not gonna take it. No! It just doesn't have the same effect without hair. Next verse. Next verse, watch this. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive. When should I believe I receive? When I have it or when I pray? When I pray, and you shall have. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now the next two, because I'm going to touch these and we are done. Because this is something, I've had some readjustment on this. And this will help you. And when you stand praying, forgive if you have any ought against any, that your Father which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. Next verse. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you your trespasses. Well, there you go. Ah, that's old covenant, Chris. That's before the cross. Who's ever heard that? Right? So we don't have to forgive now, right? Wrong. This applies to you and I too. Amen. But this is not talking about before God. The Bible says we've already been forgiven. Ephesians 1:7, Ephesians 4:32. We forgive because we've been forgiven, but notice we forgive. This is not about us. This is not a salvation issue. It's an access to the devil issue. You know, God can't override your will. So if I don't forgive, I'm giving Satan access. Forgiveness doesn't mean you condone something, a wrong that someone's done to you. You can hate what they've done, but you can release them. It's an act of faith. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse, we're done. We're just about done. Verses 10 and 11. Watch this. If I don't forgive, I give the enemy access. And God himself will not and cannot, because of his own word, override that. Now, I'm already forgiven as far as my eternal salvation is concerned. See, we got to understand the difference between our vertical relationship with God and our horizontal relationship in this world. Now, watch this. To whom you forgive anything. Now, how many know this is after the cross? This is the Apostle Paul talking after the cross. Watch this. To whom you forgive anything, I forgive also. For if I forgive anything, to whom I forgave it, for your sakes forgave I it in the person of Christ by faith. Next verse. Lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we're not ignorant of his devices. And if I don't forgive, God can't, I'm giving Satan access. Amen? I'm still forgiven as far as I'm born again, my eternal position for God, but I'm allowing the enemy to come in and I'm letting him have an advantage of me because of his devices. And what are his devices? You know, it literally means mind games, that which deals with the intellect. We're not ignorant of the enemy's vice. This is not, see, forgiveness is still huge. Amen. It's still huge. You know, I'll quote Derek Prince. He's since gone on to be with the Lord. But he said, the lady came to him. You know the story. I've told it, said it before. Came to him and said, you know, you, he told her, said, you need to forgive your ex-husband. Forgive my ex-husband. He's ruined the last 15 years of my life. He looked at her and said, you want him to ruin the next 15?
All right.
Amen.
All right.
Amen. So forgiveness is, listen, it's huge. If I hold on to unforgiveness, I'm giving the enemy access. How many know we don't want to give a defeated foe access into our victorious life?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. So, all right. There's so much more I could say, but God doesn't want any of us to be fruitless fig trees. And approaching God based on any of our own merit outside of Christ is what implements fruitlessness in my life. How many know God wants me to be fruitful? And part of being fruitful is having my prayers answered. A big part of being fruitful is seeing God's activity in my life, even when I don't do everything right, even when I'm not perfect, even when none of those things are there, but it's all because of him. That's what faith is about. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. You're blessed. Give the Lord a hand. Thank you, Jesus. If anybody here is not